parents and also about the project that I'm working on at the University of Geneva. I'm delighted to see so many people in the room, which shows that there is an interest in this kind of topic, because I think it is something that, for the reasons that Nina just highlighted, is extremely topical. And what I would like to focus on today, actually, in terms of training, is really, there's one thing I want you to walk away with, is an awareness of the importance of the wider context in terms of interpreter training and what it means to be working as an interpreter in contexts that are characterized by a high degree of volatility, change, human suffering, and where there are many factors that are outside the control of the individuals operating in that context in a much more acute way than is generally the case. Before I start, though, I would like to acknowledge two people whose intellectual contributions are certainly visible in this talk. Although I'm drawing largely on my own training experiences, all of our training in the past years at the Inzone project at the University of Geneva has been collaborative, and mainly Professor Barbara Moser-Mercer and a former colleague, Leila Gerbisch, have influenced me a lot in terms of my training, and I would like to acknowledge their contribution at this stage. What are we talking about when we say humanitarian term? Well, that term was something that, when our project started in 2010, was not really a term that was out there or widely used. And it started out as more of a working hypothesis, based on the assumption that maybe there is something specific to interpreting in a humanitarian context and for humanitarian organizations. Over the years, and through our experiences with different organizations, and this is something that is very important to keep in mind, we came up with a tentative definition. And I would like to argue that this definition is very much work in progress. Why? Because the humanitarian field as a whole is characterized by very heterogeneous organizations. You have the oldest humanitarian organization, which is the ICRC, the International Committee of the Red Cross, that has a very specific understanding of what the term humanitarian means and where the humanitarian field ends and where it begins. And then you have other organizations, new organizations, or old organizations, the NGOs operating in this field, or even UN organizations operating in this field, that have a different understanding. So for example, if we look at the UNHCR, well, the UNHCR, because it takes care of refugees, kind of falls into the humanitarian context at this stage, because international humanitarian law has four core conventions. These are the Geneva Conventions, and these are the foundation of the International Committee of the Red Cross. And these four core conventions are really just about war and armed conflict, and about the laws that are to be applied within war and armed conflict. Then in 1951, the UNHCR came along with the Refugee Convention that was added to the existing body of humanitarian law. Why? Because 1951, there were millions of displaced people after World War II, and all of a sudden, the issue of refugees was very high on the political agenda and on the geopolitical agenda, as is again the case today. However, this was actually a first shift, I would say, in terms of how the humanitarian field is defined, because refugee contexts go beyond mere conflict. So very often these are post-conflict settings, or as it is called today in international English, protracted emergencies. So a protracted emergency is an emergency that can last for anywhere between 20 and 50 years. There's really no end to it. It's really no longer an emergency. But in a certain sense it is, because it's still part of the international humanitarian law. So if you look at situations, for example, Somali refugees in Kenya, there are millions of them still in Kenya who arrived in the early 90s. And we have second and third generation refugees. who were born in Kenya, but as children or grandchildren of refugees, and they are considered to be still in a situation of post-conflict because of their refugee status, even though they live in an environment that is not characterized now. Then we have the whole issue of human rights law, etc. Therefore, I would like to emphasize that this is the definition that we are currently, that we currently arrived at, very much based on our own training experiences in this context. But it is a definition that is likely to evolve and to change. Also because geopolitically what we now see increasingly is that humanitarian action and development aid are brought closer and closer together. And it becomes in practice very difficult to define where humanitarian work ends and where development aid begins. So what we agreed on is that generally these humanitarian interpreters somehow work in fragile environments. Most often in environments that fall under international humanitarian law. They work for humanitarian organizations, which means that these organizations have a humanitarian mandate and work closely with beneficiaries that are in some way or another considered vulnerable under international law. So we have situations of human suffering. It can be very acute human suffering, situations where people lack food and water, and it can be more indirect or more long-term human suffering, such as refugees who have psychological trauma, etc., due to displacement. And in general, these are interpreters who work with beneficiaries protected under international humanitarian law. So, as I mentioned earlier, it's quite tricky in practice to clearly delineate the humanitarian field, and it's also not the objective of this talk today. So suffice it to say for our purposes that as far as interpreting is concerned, we have settings where international humanitarian law clearly applies. We have settings that are still considered humanitarian settings, but do not fall under IHL because they are not due to armed conflict. So for example, when you have natural disasters or famine, this obviously entails great amounts of human suffering, but unless it is linked directly to an armed conflict, it does not fall under the Geneva Conventions. And then there are other situations that bear many similarities to the archetypical humanitarian situations, such as human rights violations, protracted emergencies, etc. So as far as interpreting is concerned, I would apply the following rule of thumb, which academics refer to as a heuristic. What we have to see, what we have to take into consideration is, well, are the training needs for interpreters working in that context, are they somehow similar to what we've generally seen in typically humanitarian organizations? And do the same ethical principles apply to the overall context? And once we have ascertained that, we can then look at the experiences we already have in terms of humanitarian interpreter training. And one thing that emerged over several years of training was that we realized that we were faced with different types of interpreters. And you could kind of place these in two categories, insiders and outsiders. Insiders and outsiders in terms of what? In terms of the population of beneficiaries of humanitarian action in a specific context. And obviously, in reality, I don't want you to think of insiders and outsiders as two very clearly delineated and defined categories. Like everything else in life, it is a simplification and it is, in general, a continuum. You can be a little bit more of an insider in terms of culture, and you can be a little bit more of an outsider in other regards, for example, because you are more educated than other members of your community. So insiders and outsiders is really just two categories for simplification. And of course, who is an insider and who is an outsider depends on where you place yourself. When I say insider interpreters, what I'm referring to are interpreters who are recruited from the population of beneficiaries. So if you have a group of Somali refugees in a refugee camp, and these are interacting with UNHCR officials, the interpreter recruited from that group of Somali refugees, for me, is what I call an insider. if you have somebody who works for ICRC, and a surprising amount of ICRC interpreters are actually graduates from SOAS in London, who for some reason when they were 18 decided to learn a rare language, not thinking that they would ever gain employment because of it, but they end up learning Hindi or Urdu or Tamil, and all of a sudden become very interesting for ICRC because they need these languages, and it is policy of the organization not to use insiders. The ICRC in its approach differs from UNHCR because it specifically does not want people to be sent into their countries of origin or into countries where they have family ties in order to interpret. So here you have so-called outsider interpreters who are aid workers, just like their colleagues who are not interpreters, who are expatriates, who are employed formally by the organization. So from there you see that you have fairly different profiles. On one hand you might have a young British SOAS graduate who is fluent in English and Hindi, and on the other hand you have a Somali refugee who somehow through his primary and secondary school managed to achieve a solid level of English and also speaks Somali, and somebody told him, hey, come and interpret for us. It's not really a career, but you're here in the camp, what else can you do? And they get recruited to interpret. So obviously, you cannot train these two groups using exactly the same pedagogical approaches. On the other hand, what they do have in common is that they're ultimately expected to basically do the same job. What does that job consist of? We will get to that in a minute. But first, let me just summarize the two main categories that I want to look at today. So on one hand we have the UNHCR interpreter, typically refugee, typically fairly low level of education. They might have finished secondary school. Depending on their personal background, how old they were when they arrived in the camp, were they young enough to start from primary school, or did they have big gaps in their schooling because of displacement? They will master their mother tongue or several local languages as well as English, and in some cases French, but generally the language of the UN in these settings tends to be English, even in French-speaking countries. In terms of the community, that is the beneficiary community, they are a member of that community. So they have insider knowledge of the culture, or at least they are part of the members of that culture, so they think they have as much knowledge as anybody else. And in terms of their work relationship with their employer, they are very often, in many countries, what is called an incentive worker. I can give you the example of Kenya, which is the country I know best. In Kenya, refugees are not allowed to work. They're not allowed to legally seek employment. However, UNHCR negotiated an exception with the Kenyan authorities so that they can actually recruit refugees for tasks that they cannot use the local population for. And typically interpreting is such a task because not many Kenyan nationals will speak languages from South Sudan or from Eastern Congo or even Somalia, although there are Kenyan Somalis who also work as interpreters. So incentive work is one of the only options for refugees to seek to gain legal employment. The remuneration for incentive work is very, very low. It is low in absolute terms and it is low in relative terms. The career options are obviously very limited. You can be an incentive worker and that's pretty much it. And generally the interpreters that we've trained working for UNHCR have some kind of work experience because they just start working as interpreters without any prior training. So generally we can draw on the fact that they have considerable experience but often have received no formal training, not only as interpreters but actually no professional training in any language. So they're not even used to maybe thinking about the act of interpreting as something that can be done. Very different for ICRC. Here we have people with university degrees, at minimum a BA, but I've had people in my classes who have two doctorates. So it really depends. It's a range of people, generally very educated, well-traveled. They speak English, plus often their mother tongue, which can be German, Italian, Spanish, and this exotic, acquired, rare language that ICRC needs. They're employed by ICRC with the same benefits as the ICRC delegates. So they're sent to generally conflict zones as expatriate workers. As far as the culture is concerned, well, they've read about it, they studied it, they often lived in the country for a very long time. So they have cultural knowledge that is maybe more structured and more academic than an insider interpreter would have. But very often, in terms of their foreign language, they also have gaps in their knowledge. And improving that language, enhancing that language, is actually one of their priorities in terms of training. And as I mentioned, well, they are employees, they have some career options inside ICRC, even though many, in order to progress, will have to change and no longer be interpreters, because there's only so much advancement you can have as an interpreter. And some of them have work experience in terms of interpreting when we train them. Some of them don't. In general, what ICRC does, unlike many other organizations, they have a very structured induction program. So when you join ICRC, you do an integration course that generally takes, I think, 2 or 3 weeks. And when we were training for ICRC, we managed to do that training at the end of the integration course. So very often our trainees were new recruits who had no field experience or very little field experience. But then others were brought back from the field in order to take part in interpreter training because they were not available at another session. So it was quite mixed. Quick parenthesis on skill acquisition in interpreting. In the literature, mostly from cognitive psychology, skill acquisition and performance, so skill acquisition, which is basically a progressive improvement in somebody's performance, is believed to be mediated by 3 main factors: capacity, motivation, and opportunity. And if we look at the training that we provide as an opportunity for skill acquisition, then we would have to take into account what the pre-existing capacity and pre-existing motivation of our trainees is. And there are some factors influencing the two, obviously, and once again, these are quite different depending on which population of interpreters you look at. So for motivation, of course, if you are an incentive worker before training, and you will be an incentive worker after training, and going through the training requires you to work hard, but there will not be any tangible benefits, that has an impact on motivation. And in the Western education settings, we are used to students who, like many of you and like all of us, pursue their education because they are thinking about something that they want to do beyond their education. So it's a very future-oriented thing to do, pursuing education. But what happens when the time spent in the classroom becomes an objective in itself? Because there might not be any ulterior goals. So that means as trainers, it's extremely challenging, because as trainers, it means we have to make things as interesting and as immediately useful as possible. Because basically, the students have to take part in our training for the sake of spending that time with us, which is not easy as a trainer. And then, of course, the motivation is also influenced by the relationship with the community you work with and your personal motivations. Somebody who signs up consciously as a European, to go to a conflict zone as a multilingual aid worker or interpreter has very different motivations from somebody who, due to displacement, ended up in a refugee camp and ends up as an interpreter. There's a huge difference in terms of personal agency between these two groups. As far as the capacity is concerned, I already mentioned briefly, from a pure language perspective, I would say that very often with refugee interpreters, we see that what they find challenging is the international language, so the foreign language, generally English, will be more challenging for them than their native language. And for the ICRC interpreters, it is often the other way around. because they are using a language that they have acquired often as adults and that they have limited mastery of, or at least that they feel less confident in than in English. And of course the general level of education, etc., all things we have to take into account in creating opportunities for these two groups to acquire skills. And amongst the most important skills humanitarian interpreters need for their work is the ability to make ethical decisions. And I would like to look at ethics here not as something that you read about, but really as a skill. The ability to make decisions in context, because that is the key difference between interpreters and translators. Interpreters do not have the luxury of sitting back and reflecting, maybe after the fact, but they need to make a decision in a very specific communication situation that can be quite challenging. What does this situation look like in general? Well, interpreting, you can think of it as not a dialogue, but a trialogue. You have mediated communication. And ideally, I don't know if you can all see this, but ideally you have two speakers, speaker one and speaker two, who want to communicate with each other. And ideally communication happens across those green arrows, with both speakers speaking to each other through the interpreter. In reality, those of you who maybe have interpreted between two people know that this is rarely the case. Generally, both of the speakers will turn to you and they will be speaking to you. And that is all fine and well, as long as everybody stays in the loop. But obviously, the reason you're there to start with is because these speakers do not understand each other. So what happens when speaker one addresses the interpreter is that all of a sudden there's a side conversation between speaker one and the interpreter. And speaker two is excluded, he's out of the loop. He sometimes might not know what is going on. And generally, a very interesting thing about human nature is that if there are three people in a room and two people start talking to each other in a language the third person does not understand, we automatically think they're talking about us. That is what speaker two is most likely to feel in this situation. And I'm not going to go into detail, but if you think about it also in terms of the power relationship that exists, it can have a very important and very damaging impact. So in training, we try to make our trainees aware of what happens in a situation. What happens when a side conversation starts? And you know, this might be innocent enough. You, instead of translating the answer directly, you want to get a bit more information so that you can give speaker two a more comprehensive account. So you go back and forth with the beneficiary that you're interpreting for. But what happens is it entails a breakdown of communication between the two persons who are supposed to communicate with each other, and it entails a breakdown of trust in the overall communication situation. And as far as core ethical principles are concerned, it means that all of a sudden, as an interpreter, you're no longer between the two, but you've taken side. Conceptually, sometimes even physically. And this is why this triangle is not just a tool to think about interpreting, but it also refers to a very specific seating arrangement in a room. Because we can take sides physically just by sitting with, siding with one party. And so conceptually, this was a little bit the framework trying to create different situations, replay different dynamics between three parties and see what the consequences are in terms of ethical principles. And these ethical principles are commonly associated with interpreting. You will find them in many codes of ethics for interpreters. But you will find them, or very similar ethical principles, also as the humanitarian principles. And that is something that makes that humanitarian field particularly interesting in terms of training, because interpreters are part of a wider context that is supposed to live by the same principles, and they are. And that is something you can use to your advantage for training. So let's see how this triangle can be applied in this insider scenario. So as I mentioned, I have my UNHCR refugee interpreter that I'm supposed to train. He lives in a Kenyan refugee camp. Or as an example, let's take Kakuma refugee camp. His mother tongue is Somali, and he's supposed to interpret between Somali and English. And the most common situation my interpreter will encounter is an RSD interview, refugee status determination. What does that mean? It means that people arrive, newly arrive in the camp, and they need to register with UNHCR. And UNHCR needs to ascertain whether or not they fulfill the criteria to be recognized as refugees. And so it means that the individual of concern, who is not yet a refugee, we don't know, refugee with a question mark, has to talk to a UNHCR officer, recount his life experiences, how they arrived there, why they were displaced, family situations typically, how many children, etc., etc. So basically trace down their personal history, mediated through an interpreter. And so obviously, this is, in terms of the IC's life, this interview is incredibly important. This person's life, to a certain extent, depends on the outcome of that RSD interview. So the stakes, the emotional stakes, the personal stakes are extremely high. And that individual most likely will recognize the interpreter as a member of their community. And they will be intimidated by the whole international setup, an expatriate sitting there with notes, writing down everything. They have to talk about very painful experiences. So there's a lot of pressure on the IC. And the IC does what any other human being would do in that situation. Looks at the only other person that he thinks can understand him for support. And obviously, so the expectations towards the interpreter are very high. And many people have never worked with or through an interpreter before, so they don't quite understand what the role of that person is. And why is he there? Is he there to assess me? Is he there to see whether I'm telling the truth or not? And then they know that in the evening, that interpreter is going home back with them to the same community. They're living in the same place. So maybe if I go to his house in the evening and talk to him a little bit, I can convince him to, you know, put in a good word for me with UNHCR so that they make a good decision. These are the kind of stakes you will be confronted with in this setting. So what does that mean in terms of communication, in terms of ethics? Well, one thing we realize is that with the interpreters recruited from the local community, as I said earlier, there was not maybe initially a decision to become part of the humanitarian field and to do humanitarian work. So you cannot expect these interpreters to necessarily have a very thorough understanding of humanitarian principles. So you cannot use these humanitarian principles in order to then say, well, see, interpreting is just like that, same ethical. But what these interpreters have is a wealth of experience and a wealth of challenges that they have encountered and that you can work with and that you can put in context and using very simple tools like this triangle, say, okay, tell me what happened in that interview, and they will tell you, and then you say, you see, here what actually happened is that this person was excluded from the communication. Or you were put under a lot of pressure because all of a sudden you were not expected to be an interpreter, you were expected to be there for psychological or moral support. And one of the specificities of this training context, especially for me coming into that context, obviously I'm an interpreter by training. For me, interpreting is a profession, and I have a very clear understanding of what the role of an interpreter is. An understanding that is not innate. It's an understanding that I developed through my professional practice and because I was told Well, as an interpreter, your role is this, but if somebody asks you to do this, you can say, no, that is not my role. But if you're thrown in a very complex communication setting that is multilingual, that is multicultural, that has huge power asymmetries between different speakers, where you also have to find your own position. Because don't forget, we're in a setting where, yes, the interpreter in the triangle, it looks like the interpreter is very much on top, but the interpreter is also a refugee. The interpreter is also a beneficiary of the aid that organization is giving. So there is a power asymmetry between the officer and the interpreter, between the interpreter and the IC, between the officer and the IC. And generally, what happens in situations where we're not very confident or where we feel insecure because we don't understand the rules very much is, well, we try to stick to what we know best. And we try to do what we feel most comfortable doing. And we try to establish our strengths and to show our strengths, especially to maybe our employer or representative of our employer that we're trying to impress to some extent. And one of the strengths of interpreters who are members of the local community is, of course, that they have a very detailed understanding of the local culture. So the temptation to go and volunteer a lot of cultural information in order to give the officer more context, that temptation is very great. On the other hand, for the individual, that is also to a certain extent a risk, because it means that you are volunteering cultural knowledge and you are extrapolating from your personal experience, but your experience of a certain culture might not be generalizable to every member. So in terms of training, roughly, the approach we adopted was an approach of abstraction. Taking trainees from their very concrete experiences, working with these experiences, and gradually abstracting from these experiences towards the higher level ethical principles. Saying, well, you said you experienced this. Here we have something to do with impartiality or charity. For ICRC, the approach is quite different. I already mentioned who the interpreters are, and one of the most common communication settings is the EST, entretien sans témoin, which is generally generally in a detention setting. So you have one or several detainees, you have an ICRC delegate, and you have an interpreter, and nobody else. This is why it's called an interview without witnesses. And the task of the ICRC representatives, in particular the ICRC delegate, is to find out more about the conditions, the detention conditions, to see whether international humanitarian law is being respected, in particular for prisoners of war, for example. So the ICRC was one of the only organizations that was allowed inside Guantanamo, for example. And another objective is also to help detainees re-establish family ties and family relationships. And maybe some of you know that the ICRC had a very big role in terms of re-establishing family relationships amongst displaced populations after World War II. And there huge databases of families, and each person had a little card, etc. Obviously, today it's much easier because we have methods of communication that make that easier. And we have the interpreter, who is an expatriate and generally not from the country where he is posted. What happens here is that in terms of training, we can, to some extent, rely on the fact that we are confronted with individuals who have a fairly good understanding of what humanitarian work is, what the stakes are, and what that entails. So our work is more one of application of these principles to interpretation rather than abstraction. Also because some of our trainees do not have any prior interpreting experience. And generally, we do that, we use a lot of role plays and situations that we know about, because we know some of the ethical challenges and we sometimes elicit them from the trainees as well, and then try to put them in context with role plays. So here, the idea, once again, is to make them aware of everything that is going on in a trialogue scenario, and to make them aware of what their role is, what their role is not. And an additional thing that maybe I should have mentioned earlier is that one thing that makes it quite difficult in terms of this definition of somebody's role as an interpreter is that very often humanitarian interpreters are not only interpreters. Because they work in environments that are characterized by a constant state of emergency. Everybody's overworked in the field. And very often interpreters will not just do nothing when there's no interviewing going on. They will have a variety of other tasks. Or sometimes what might happen is that given that it is that an interpreter might actually be doing an interview alone, directly in the language of the detainee, but in that case he's no longer an interpreter. So that is another important factor, is that interpreting is not, it becomes part of your personality, obviously, but in terms of a role, it is something that you step into and that you step out of. And this is another thing where this kind of very simple tool helps, because the minute you are engaging in a side conversation with one of the parties, you have stepped out of that role. And in some situations, that might be appropriate. If you are doing an interview with a detainee, you as an interpreter are doing an interview with a detainee that you've already seen two or three times before, but the delegate is new, you might want to first exchange a few words with the detainee, because after all, he's a human being that you've encountered before. And maybe you want to ask him how he's doing and say hello, and there's no problem with that. However, this is something that requires a very clear understanding of where the role of an interpreter ends, where it begins, in terms of space and in terms of time as well. So all of that somehow needs to be brought into the training, and we found that it makes much more sense to train that through complex role plays and practice than to try to present that as part of a more theoretical setup. So in conclusion, as far as ethical decision-making skills for humanitarian interpreters are concerned, we've come up with two approaches that take the background of the trainees into account. We found that the overall humanitarian principles and the code of ethics that characterizes the humanitarian work is very useful in this context, because it overlaps to a great extent with the ethical principles that apply to interpretation. And another important factor is that this contextualization is also one of the key things that help us, key arguments that help us establish the relevance of our training. One thing that is important is that if you train interpreters who work in a specific context, your credibility hinges upon your understanding of that context. And if you do not understand the context, no matter how well you've read skill acquisition theory and interpreting, no matter how excellent you are as a pedagogue, as a trainer, it becomes irrelevant because you've lost your audience at that point. So in some situations, this part of establishing your own credibility is can be a challenge for trainers, especially new trainers. And that is why we found it, at least in my experiences, I found it very useful to work with a colleague who had actually worked as an interpreter for ICRC. And then once I started training in the field as well, that gave me a better understanding of the context. And with that, I'm at the end of the official part of the presentation. Thank you.